Please be sure to watch the video to its end, as there is a special note at the end of part two. When I think of it, my fingers turn. So there I was, back in Oklahoma, living only a mile away from Oral Roberts University with my on-again, off-again girlfriend. I didn't feel as though I had come full circle, even though driving by some of the landmarks in Tulsa, interspersed between the thousands of churches, I was reminded a lot of what I left behind when I dropped out of college 4 years prior. Mary was still in Tulsa, and while we did meet once to talk about where we were in our lives, we both saw that we were on two different journeys, and while what we had was beautiful, and perhaps even perfect, the intervening years and the experiences of those years in our lives had created two terribly different people. I remember meeting up with her and wondering if there would still be any sign of a spark between us. After a couple of hours, I had to resign myself to the fact that she was as lost to me as I was lost in this world. I was forced to move on with my life, knowing that she would never be a part of it ever again. When mourning one's past, it's easy to think that you still have a chance to right the wrongs of yesterday, and if you allow yourself this selfish philosophy, you can spend all of your time missing the gems that are at your feet and in your hands by looking up at the stars and thinking that if you just concentrate and wish hard enough, they will become yours. After a time, my relationship with the girl I moved to Tulsa with degenerated into a constant battle of wills, with me becoming a verbally abusive, emotionally damning, heartless monster that sought nothing less than the complete obliteration of the confidence, intelligence, and empathy I once held dear and true. I vividly remember many arguments that ended with me screaming at her about how worthless she was, about how she would never amount to anything, and about how no one could ever love her for who she is, and how I was never going to spend any more time or energy on her. Reducing her to tears and ripping away any care she might have still had for me, I gloated over her in a sense of superiority, a sense of victory. I believed that the emotions I was displaying were finally the real me. That and the considerate, caring, empathetic, kind, and loving person I had been was all a sham. All an attempt to put on a mask for the world so that I could get what I wanted or at least not cause any waves. My anger at everything twisted my mind so greatly that I honestly believed that brutal, cruel, and uncaring honesty of opinion was the only true way to express oneself. I had gone from being a charismatic and charming young man to being an asshole. And then after seeing that being an asshole can actually get you what you want out of people sometimes, I went all out and just became a complete, total dick. I mocked other people's ideas, I mocked their problems as petty or inconsequential, and basically my friends knew that while I could be fun if I was drinking, I was probably going to eventually say something that was harsh and couldn't be taken any other way than me just being a dick. Although the cliche of girls liking bad boys is mostly true, there's a limit. And as I pushed this girl further and further away from me, leached out all compassion towards me and hope she had for us, spent every day reducing her confidence and her willpower, and my friends reinforcing my delusional state by shunning me, I finally realized I'd gone over that limit and found myself spending long nights alone and lonely, angry at myself again for thinking I had it right. And that they were the ones that were just jealous of my intellect, envious of my fuck-off manner, and lustful over my ability to seemingly not give a damn about anything. And so it was, 1 year after moving to Tulsa, I was living alone, working two jobs, no social life, no friends, no nothing. I had secretly signed a new lease on the apartment I moved into with the girl that moved to Tulsa with me, but this time it didn't have her name on it. I remember typing up my own eviction notice to give to her and giving her 1 month to get out of the apartment. She took it rather well, I remember, but I think that maybe there was very little positive emotion left in her at that point in regards to her and me. I had shown her so much hatred. I think she held on as long as she could, and I finally decided for her that it was time to leave. There comes a time in many relationships where we know that we're done. Most of the time we stick around for a bit longer after that realization, sometimes we stick around for a long time, and sometimes we think so lowly of ourselves and our dreams and hopes that we stay in them for the rest of our lives. Lying in bed at night, we listen to the breathing beside us and it's alien to us. Our thoughts that used to center around that person lying next to us strive to find something new to live for, search for some reason why we stay, hope that something happens that will rip the final threads of the relationship so that we can go back out and try again with hopefully better results. I was working 70 hours a week between the two jobs after she moved out, and while I like to think that was because I had a strong work ethic, or that I was planning on putting the money earned towards repairing my credit or paying off my debts, neither of these really hit the core of why I spent all of my time outside of my apartment. The truth of the matter is that I was miserable and angry, and every minute I spent in my apartment was another minute I had to deal with being alone again, with having had so much love given to me by another person, and not appreciating it, not accepting it, not putting aside my hatred for living long enough to realize life isn't supposed to be lived by burning every bridge, every field, and every person. In the summer of 2001, at the prodding of some of my coworkers, I started attending a local poetry night at the coffee shop downtown. I attended 3 or 4 nights without joining in, but after spending so many nights in the bars or one of the many 24-hour diners in town with some of the participants in poetry night, I finally sat down and started writing again. It started with rants, mostly, performance pieces that were tailored to appeal to the nonconformist crowd I was starting to identify with at least a bit. I never really fit the bill of nonconformist, as I dressed decently within normal fashion of the time period. I didn't think the system was out to get me so much so that I couldn't overcome it with hard work and dedication, and I actually had a job. 2 jobs. So unlike the unwashed masses of Poetry Night, I generally brought my own smokes and bought my own drinks. After many months of performing every Wednesday night, my new version of church, I started to get disillusioned by the angry rants and ravings I saw being presented after September 11th, 2001. Up until then, I had been a staunch Republican and thought Clinton was a bad president, Bush Jr. was this country's savior, and that abortion was wrong even though I had been instrumental in one being performed. Sodomy was wrong, although my sexual experiences with the female persuasion had included at least the dictionary definition of sodomy. Homosexuality was wrong because it, quote, wasn't natural, unquote. Socialism was godless communism, and basically everything else you could think of that the Republican Party has stood for over the years. Interestingly enough, it was reading about conspiracy theories in regards to the World Trade Center and the events of September 11, 2001 that caused me to question my stance on politics, and I found myself defending my country with hollow words and bullet points I'd read on news websites. I didn't really feel it anymore, and that's when I realized that my anger tank was getting empty. I started to understand that people were important, that people were what made our society great, and that the pains and sufferings of others should be a priority. Somewhere inside me, I was starting to regain some of the empathy I thought I had lost forever. Regaining that empathy took me somewhere even I had no clue about, and the course I chose in the fall of 2001 was a surefire way to refill my tank of angry. What is the purpose of human and my existence? I am here for a reason only God knows. I can't know everything. I can only ask God to reveal what He wants me to do. Why am I here? I know that the Bible says that I am here to spread the word of God, but what about the unsaved? Are they here just to give us something to do? I don't know. Life is a mystery. We are born to die, and we die to be freed from this world and its pains. What is the point of it all? There has to be a point. Is life just the trial that we have to go through to get to the final reward on the other side? No, that doesn't make sense, but then again, nothing ever does. You can't make sense in such a messed up universe. Today's adults and leaders tell us constantly that we will amount to nothing. Generation X, they say, and I resent that. We are overachievers. But to what purpose? What final goal is there? Death? No, there has to be more to life than that. I know there is something after death, but while we are here and alive, what does that matter? I don't know what the answer to human existence is, and I don't think we will know while we in our human form are still alive. It's a question only capable of being answered by someone higher up. 17 years old and just as questioning in my purpose here on Earth, I see that I was still hopeful and optimistic about my future, even if the anger was already peeking around the corner. Over the past 16 years, I've used the point that I stated as a teenager many times. While we were here and alive, what does an afterlife matter? I don't think that the majority of Christians think about this question very clearly. Their actions denote that they believe it, but when they are asked outright about their purpose, they will flit and flounder and spit out some Bible verses about go ye into the world and preach the gospel or seek first the kingdom of heaven. But the reality of it is that most of them are here to do what we all are here to do. Further knowledge, teach others by way of having children for the most part, and strive to improve our own lives in hopes that those improvements will bleed over into the lives of others and eventually society. As someone commented on another of my videos, and as I'm starting to see a trend of this being pointed out in other YouTube videos, the lukewarm Christian, the unreligious religious, and the outright hypocrites, greatly outnumber the vocal minority that is currently trying to push their beliefs of what they think our existence is supposed to be onto others. If the point of existence is simply to use up all that we have been granted by a god, then the selfish and the greedy are to be exemplified as the highest order of human beings we could hope to attain. But seeing as how this isn't the Christian way, this isn't the way we're supposed to move forward as a global society, the aforementioned majority of believers shy away from supporting this idea but still support a system that rewards this greed and selfishness. My existence is all that I have. Ignoring the arguments for or against an afterlife or previous lives, there is only this one chance. There is only from birth to death and the experiences and the effects we have on others and our world, both positive and negative. To be stuck in a crisis of existence is to not live. Thinking that the answers to all the questions are out there, and if only one seeks long enough that they will find all of those answers and finally be able to take another step forward, is detrimental to experiencing this glorious life and this wondrous existence. Since losing God, I've stopped looking into the supernatural for answers to where I should be or what those ethereal beings have planned for my life, and I've regained the sovereignty I relinquished when I gave my life and my hope and my plans and my decisions and my dreams to an imaginary friend that could offer me no answers and no guidance, but could offer me false comfort when I thought nothing else would sustain me, and when I thought that the world was conspiring against its plan for my life, and when I was unable to imagine, let alone live, a life where I was in control of my own destiny. As many of you know, based on the view count, I've started a secondary channel. So far, there are only ramblings about me, my life, and some thoughts that go through my head. I hope to use this secondary channel as an all-original channel that will eventually see videos of the same caliber you are used to here on Xander's Meteor. But for the time being, it will be a sort of Xander Unplugged with no scripts, no cuts, no editing, just me. While there is no solid reason why you should subscribe to yet another channel, I hope to also use the second channel to post commentary on the videos I upload here, so keep an eye out for those. Thanks again to all of you for making this channel a hit, and as I finally crossed over and stayed over 800 subs, there may be a celebratory video posted midweek next week.